shed unto me. Let us go to the house of the Lord. Let us worship. Oh, I was glad when you said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Let us worship. Let us worship. Let us worship. Let us worship. I was glad when you said unto me, said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord, and let us worship. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord. Said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord and worship. Lord, we worship you. Oh, I was glad when they said unto me, let us go to the house of the Lord and worship. Lord, we praise him, all ye people. Praise him, all ye nations. Praise him, all ye saints. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. We praise you, Lord. Praise Him, all ye people. Praise Him, all ye nations. Praise Him, all ye saints. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise Him, all ye people. Praise Him, all ye nations. Praise Him, all His saints. Praise the Lord. Oh, 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 praise the Lord.
Praise you, Lord.
Oh, praise the Lord.
Let's praise the Lord. Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord. We praise you, Lord. Praise Him, all His saints. Praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Oh, praise the Lord. Praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. joy. Always singing. We bless you, Lord. We bless you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We praise you.
Father, we praise you. Blessed praise you. Holy Spirit now. Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit now. Father, we thank you. Lord Jesus, we thank you.
Your river is flowing. clothed in tongues of fire. Holy Spirit, now your rivers flowing rapidly, wildly. My Holy Spirit, now your rushing mighty wind. Holy Spirit, now your clothed in tongues of fire. Holy Spirit, now your rivers flowing rapidly through my life. For everyone to see, let God be glorified, let Jesus Christ be revealed. Holy Spirit, now, oh, Holy Spirit, now, you're a shaking mighty wind. Oh, Holy Spirit, now, you're clothed in tongues of fire. Oh, Holy Spirit, now, you're
well, seeing as some of you don't get it, I'll just go ahead and talk to you about it a little while. Because the more we talk about it, the more, you know, the word goes forth, the more the possibility the word gets mixed with faith. And as soon as the word gets mixed with faith, as soon as the word gets mixed with faith, then the glory of heaven begins to be revealed. And the power of the Holy Ghost begins to be made manifest to you and through you. To start off today. Today is actually the beginning, the early beginnings of a Jewish holiday, a holy day that has been, it's really been altered. It's called Rosh Hashanah, but really it's not the first of the year. First of the year is Passover. Hallelujah. Now, you don't know what that means. That's why you're looking at me like that and didn't start shouting. So I'll help you understand. First year is Passover. That's when Jesus was slain. And everything that happened in Egypt and all the way through until the day that Christ Jesus came was all God talking about a whole new beginning. This is when it all begins. So it all begins for you. This is the first of every year. This is the first of it all. Hallelujah. First fruits of creation. Come in. Hallelujah. Really, the first fruits of creation in many respects came into being there at the cross of Calvary. Though he was born, you know, 33 and a half years approximately earlier. That was the first day of creation. First fruits of creation, okay? And so, you know, through a lot of different things, this holiday that we're getting ready to celebrate starting this evening, Rosh Hashanah, is actually Yom Tahura, which is the day of shouting. It's the day of shouting. It's the day of trumpet blast. Yeah. Yom Teruah is a day of shoutings. And somebody said, well, we need to observe these holidays. I said, what are you talking about? I live in it. Come on, wait. Why, I'm going to do it once a year? Give me a break. I'm in the new creation. I'm in the messianic age. I'm living in redemption. Ha! Listen, I'll tell you something. The more you feel the love and the more you feel the joy, the more the working of the Holy Spirit's being allowed free course in your life. And not about how much you being loved by God and being all caught up in, oh God, you love me, but feeling the love for everybody else. Because that's what God does. When you feel the love for everybody else, you don't have to wonder whether God's loving you, because he's loving through you. My goodness, he doesn't love through you without loving you. You know what I'm saying? Come on, people. It's really hard for me to be just really getting too excited about worship when everybody's standing around like a wet blanket in a party. You know, come on now. The Spirit of the living God has been poured out without measure. And somebody don't even know what that means. And many people don't even know what that means. That means the glory of heaven has come and flooded our lives and is being expressed to our soul and spirit, our being, like wild rushing rivers flowing rapidly. If there's anything that you want to learn how to do, you want to learn how to flow and feel the love and feel the joy. The more you feel the love, the more you feel the joy, what will happen to you is you'll begin to experience miracles and signs and wonders, the explosions of the living God on the inside of you. It's not hard. You want to make it intellectual. You want to make it a crisis. It's the heart. If I could get everybody today to just turn your heart towards heaven and begin to thank God for what he's done for you without crying about it. I want you to get past the weeping and get the joy when the baby's born. Okay, we were stuck in their labor pains. And too many people's lives stuck, like it's like the baby stuck in the birth canal. Just give me a break, please, would you? Please. Redemption is not that difficult. Redemption is a whole new life reset by the power of the living God. For you and I get to live in his joy and his love. Hallelujah. You know, there are a number of things that I really began to do in my life. One of them was to identify any kind of intimidation and kind of fear and just with great force refuse it. Any kind of sense of inferiority, any kind of sense of rejection, any kind of, you know. My thing isn't about everybody accepting me. My thing is about going accepting everybody. My thing isn't about everybody loving me. My thing is about going and loving everybody. My thing isn't playing off of whether or not people are happy. My thing is going and showing forth his joy and his goodness. And because that's God's thing. God produced that thing inside of me. And so he just wants me to cooperate with him. He wants me to cooperate with him. You can be seated. Just listen. God wants you to cooperate with him. God doesn't want you to try so hard. He wants you to cooperate with him. Cooperate. That means you're going to operate in conjunction with God. Huh? You're going to operate. You're going to function. Hallelujah. In a divine function of being under the control and leadership of the Holy Ghost. You have to go. I don't want to entertain any bugs here today. It's just a little moth. They're going to bite you. They're going to hurt you. Just kind of a little messy. Don't anybody freak out. Same way with bumblebees. Bumblebees come flying around people. Looks like somebody's trying to stab them with a knife. It isn't that bad. It's just a little teeny bug that you have authority over. Same way with the wild beast. Jesus is with a wild beast. When he went out, driven into the wilderness by the Holy Ghost to separate himself unto the Lord through fasting and prayer. Well, that's a wonderful thing to do when you get baptized by the Holy Ghost. Get baptized in the Holy Ghost, and now you want to be so close, you want to get as close as you possibly can to his divine realm of glory. Huh? Come on, man. That you just shut everything else down but him. Go way apart from every other distraction, place where only God would be there, kind of thing. Huh? The demonic realm isn't there. Demonic realm really doesn't have any reason to be out in the middle of the wilderness. Huh? There's no people to play his game with. You know what I'm saying? And that's what he's going to do. He's just going to play his hate game, his sorrow game, his sadness game, his sighing game, you know, his lust game on human beings. Father, you know, it's one of the beautiful things is he dwells in the Holy of Holies, and he's never going to leave that realm. He's opened up the door. That door is Christ Jesus. He's invited us all to come in. And I believe that if God's people would just stop the nonsense and stop all the distractions and recognize that what they really want in their life is a greater move of the Spirit of God, a greater revelation of the power and the glory of God, where their cry is, Holy Spirit, now. They just live in expectation for heaven to come with a greater force and greater revelation to you. And through you, that temptation would lose its power. Death would lose its sting. What does that mean? You wouldn't be afraid of dying at all. In fact, you'd be groaning to go ahead and move on in. Paul said, I groan in this tabernacle, being wanting to be divested of it, wanting to be, you know, relieved of it so that I could be present with the Lord. Well, that's because he's caught away in heaven realm. He's caught away in the glory realm. Hallelujah. Death has lost its sting. Huh? Death has lost its sense of loss and separation. It is a promotion. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's the great outpouring of God's power and the moving of his presence that you've been longing for all this time anyways. Hallelujah. You get to see him. But Paul said, I'm confined within the two choices. One is depart and be present with the Lord. And the other is to remain here so you can begin to understand how to cooperate with the Holy Ghost. You can begin to understand how to cooperate with this new creation, this wonderful thing that God made when he created you anew and liberated you from a demonic spirit that ruled over your life, gave you a new heart, and gave you a new spirit so that you can be receptive to love and joy. You can live out your life in praise and celebration and singing. I mean, fish were made to swim, birds were made to fly, God's people were made to praise him. I mean, that's sit around and sorrow and sighing. If you can begin to feel the love, yeah? Come on, if you can begin to feel the joy, and you give yourself to this, it gets happy around your house, don't it? It gets good. People are like, hey, Mark's coming, Ann's coming, Allie's coming, over, you're coming, whoever your name is. And they bring with them such joy, such glory, such freedom. There ain't going to be no bad talking about people. They ain't going to be just sitting around sorrowing, sighing, speculating and wondering, doubting and sorrow, wondering why we don't have. They're going to be captivated in the first and most important thing that God wants to express through our life, this freedom, hallelujah, this freedom to live, hallelujah, freedom, huh? Freedom to speak out the things that the Spirit of the Lord is saying. And literally, that's actually one of the wonderful expressions of that word freedom. It's freedom of speech. It's what it's understood at within the context of how that word was used over and over again. When we look at a word, liberty, that the Son sets free is free indeed. It's freedom to express. Freedom to express what? Freedom to express his love. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Freedom to express his joy. I pray right now that I can just grab a hold of you and bring you into a place where all you want is the outpouring of the moving of the Holy Ghost, that I could get you out of all your other stuff, all of your complaints, all of your issues, all of your, sense of failure and disappointment and whatever else is going on in your life. I just let me go over there and grab hold of your spirit and jerk you right over here into heaven. Huh? Let me just, get you past your fears and grab a hold of you and just throw you in the water and we'll teach you how to swim while you're drowning. Huh? Because I tell you, you'll really get it. If you have dry land instruction, you may not understand what it means to move those arms. But I tell you right now, if you're out there in the water and you're trying to keep your head above water, just throw you into a realm of divine power and glory. That's what we want to do for you today. We want you to get out of all of the peril of it all. All of the struggle of it all. Because the Lord didn't do it that way. He saw man in his... man was trapped in his prison. Man was trapped in an inability to ever know God and ever please God and ever walk with God. And so he came and liberated us. He came to everyone who wants to live in his love and live in his joy. Not memorize scriptures and understand what God did before he did anything. Are you understand me? Not understand how can God be all that he describes himself to be. Just come and understand the love. People just want to get all off into their intellectualism. That's why I've seen over and over again where people are just childlike and they're simple and they made the relationship with God, not about all their knowledge, but about love and about intimacy. Those people do signs, wonders, and miracles while everybody sits around, rest of everybody just sits around thinking and talking and speculating. I used to be in that trap. Thinking and talking and speculating and wondering and trying to explain. And then God in his love and his mercy, he comes and says, no. First of all, you don't have a clue what you're talking about. And second of all, I didn't make it sound about that. It's about intimacy. It's about love. It's about you and I coming over in this place of just being happy to exist. Of just being happy to be alive and just loving life and loving everything about creation, including people. Yeah. Huh? There's people that say, pastors say, I love everything about pastoring, but the people. Well, then, you know, you really messed up. You're in a trap. You're in a demonic trap. I said over and again, I love everything about pastoring with the people. And, well, the reality of it is you're caught up in the problems. What's happened is you got caught up in the problems of all the different people. That is a mess. Huh? Because then, you know, you just got your problems to deal with. What if somebody comes and tries to deal with your problems times however many they have in their church? They're just wrapped up in knots. You know what I'm saying? And so what happens rather instead that you just get all caught away in God's goodness and God's love, and that right now you could just come into a place where you begin to worship Him right now, that you begin to worship Him right now without needing the Kleenexes, that you begin to worship Him with joy in your heart and celebration. You begin to think about all that He's done for you, and now you begin to praise Him with the song. You begin to I'm open for something. I'm not talking theoretically here. Once again, Think. Try to understand how it's going to be in the future. Wonder how that's going to function. Wonder how that's going to operate. Wonder what organ's now responding to the Word of God. No, that's where people are stuck at. They're all in the mechanics of and it's only with God, because everything else comes so natural. Everything else is so easy. Huh? I mean, it's like a man and a woman, you know, trying to figure out how the lips work for the kiss, how the arms work for the hug. What does it mean? Why are we hugging? Let's think about this. Maybe in the beginning we were attached or something, and that's why this feels good. And you don't do that. You just do it. You do it. You do it because of something else. You feel something. You feel it. You don't figure out, wow, maybe. No, it's just come on over here. This is what Papa's saying. He's saying, come on up here. Come here, let me give you a hug. While you're being all ornery and messed up and feeling terrible about yourself, he said, come on over here, let me hug you. You're like, oh, I just feel so miserable, and I know God doesn't love me, and I'm so messed up. And Father's just going, hey, come on here, let me hug you. Come here. Come on now. Come here. I'm your reward. I'm your prize. Come here. I'm your prize. Come here. I guarantee you what God's idea is far better than religious ideas and all the observances. What's happened is so many people took idolatry and took all the kinds of things that belong to the religions, false religions, to try to appease the gods and brought it over in here. We're not over here trying to appease the gods. Hallelujah. Trying to get the gods happy with us so they'll bless us. We over here having God's love and mercy poured out upon us without any kind of restraint, without any kind of restriction. Wow. Hallelujah. That's why I'm so happy, because I know this. And I want to know it more. I'm so happy because I have been accepted in the beloved. If I could get people out of the condemnation culture into the accepted culture, accepted in the beloved, we won't have to do half the instruction and correction, which is a mess anyways. You're talking to people, you know, who's supposed to be flowing in the Holy Ghost and living in the life and demonstrating those wonderful things of heaven, and all they are just caught up in what everybody else has caught up, and they don't really look there's not too many distinctions between them and someone who's completely and totally lost. Someone who went out and did every evil thing you can possibly think of. In fact, sometimes people who've been doing that actually look a little bit happier than the Christian. And it's like, whoa, this is so messed up. And, you know, the Spirit of the Lord begins to move in our heart with such zeal, you know, and such holy indignation, going, give me a break. Isn't anybody going to believe God? Why is it that you're just struggling with your own acceptance, struggling with your own ability to try to, you know, get this thing right? If God needed your help, Jesus would not have had to come at all. If He just needed all the things that you can possibly do to make this thing work, He wouldn't have sent the Holy Spirit. He intervened in our life. He came in and broke us out of prison so that you and I could live with Him and walk with Him and learn to fellowship in this wonderful realm of life, which is fundamentally understood as love. Love, God's love. God's love for everybody, the love that's just as powerful when somebody hates you as it is when somebody loves you. God's blessing, a blessing that's just as powerful when somebody's persecuting you as when somebody, you know, is talking good about you and praising you. Come on, people. I mean, if God expects that of us, what do you think he's doing? You guys got to do this. I'm going to stand back here because, you know, whatever. No, he's telling us, this is who I am. I love when I'm hated. I'm blessed when I'm persecuted. I cause the rain to fall upon the wicked. You wouldn't, maybe. With some of your expressions, it would be fire falling on the wicked, not rain. I cause the sun to shine. I think some of you would do the opposite. Because, look, having begun in the Holy Ghost, you can't be made perfect by your own human efforts and by your own human ability. God knew exactly what he was getting himself into when he offered you salvation and you stepped in. I can't help it that you got yourself stuck in a realm where you're trying to somehow be acceptable to God. But I'm telling you right now, it's going to get you nowhere, and God won't allow it to get you anywhere, because we're accepted in Christ Jesus, in Christ Jesus alone. You find all of your worthiness in what he's done for us, all of your ability to please him, in the power of the authority and the authority of the Holy Ghost that's been given to us. Hallelujah. So now what you just need to do is begin to shout, begin to worship him, begin to praise him, begin to thank him for all of his goodness and all of his wonderful works which he's done for us, the children of men.
Hallelujah.
Go ahead, try just a little bit. But I don't want you to try too hard. Huh? I don't want you to try too hard, because it isn't in the volume of your voice. It's in the sincerity of your heart. God, you're just so good to me. Holy Spirit, now. Oh, Father, I thank you. Lord Jesus, I think. Let me just tell you how to give a kiss, okay? That's all I'm doing right now, is showing you how your lips work. I'm showing you how your lips work for praise. Go ahead. Go ahead. Oh, I know what it is. You come to church and you just used to be having somebody talk to you and persuade you. No. It's time for you to begin to worship him. It's time for you to begin to give thanks. It's time for you to begin to feel the love that is here. Hallelujah. It's time for you to begin to feel the joy that is here, so that could you receive what he's given, so that you can be able to give it. People trying to give something that they've never received. There is a fellowship that Father wants you to have. Go ahead.
Thank you, Father.
Go ahead. I want you to lead us in prayer right now. In other words, prayer is praise. I want you to lead us in praising thanksgiving to God right now. Just go ahead and lead us. Hallelujah. Any good? Ain't God good? Come on. Hallelujah. Ain't God good? Isn't he wonderful? Yes. You know, let me just tell you this to start off with. Maybe some of you don't know. If you call upon what Jesus did was come to not only deliver you from a life of self-destruction now, self-destruction and demonic destruction. Satan comes to claim you. You don't know this, but maybe you don't know this, but all of your sorrow, all of your affliction, all of your torment, all of your bad kind of experiences is brought by way of the demon spirits that have come to rule and control your life. Jesus came and set you free from that. He came, set you free from hell on earth, from just a merely a human existence bound up by sin and death. Hallelujah. And to liberate you in from that, to be able to bring you into a place now where you can begin to experience abundant life. People talk about it, but they still got one, they got a question mark in one eye, exclamation mark in the other eye. Question mark is, what about this? And the exclamation mark is, I don't understand. Well, you need to quit trying to figure it out and trying to, you know, ask all your questions and just start praising him and thanking him and start believing him and start moving with him, saying, I don't know how it works, but it sure is good. Come on, man. I don't understand the meaning of it all, but it sure does have a powerful effect on me. I can't explain it all. I just can tell you I want more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I mean, if I could get you to recognize that your enemy is a frown, and then you carry a mirror around with you, you know where the battle line is drawn. Hallelujah. If I could help you understand that your enemy is a bad attitude, then surely you can get enough wisdom from God and understanding from God to recognize when you have one.
Yes.
Oh, but how about the justified bad attitudes? Well, there are none. There are none. So I get you out of a place of being able to, you know, justify your wrongdoing, justify your bad attitudes, justify your wrong state. Well, I'm feeling this way because this happened, that happened, the other thing happened. The only reason that you should have ability to justify a bad state is that, number one, you're demon-possessed, you haven't been delivered by the power of God, or you're afflicted by some kind of a disease. And the good news is we can help you with all those. Good news, we can bring liberty to you today. Praise God, we're not going to fight with you. Sometimes I feel like running back, grabbing a hold of a person, putting them in a headlock, and giving them a Dutch rub. You know, say, what are you doing, huh? But I've grown out of that. Hallelujah. Guess why? Why? I am so desperate to be able to step over to heaven. I'm so longing to step over to heaven. I'm so longing to be able to encounter a greater move of God, an expression of who He is to me and through me, that that hunger itself causes me to grow and mature in His love, grow and mature in His knowledge, to grow and mature in agreement with Him. Hallelujah. Did you know that that's the whole, if you understand really in by and large, the whole of faith, and which we have made so mysterious, is all rooted in this concept of just agreeing with God, agreeing with Him, and obeying Him. Not just agreeing with Him and then going and doing your own thing. Agreeing with Him and going ahead and walking and moving with Him. And, you know, we understand this not only from context, but actually from the words that were used, as you've heard me minister recently on the first time we see the word believe in the Bible, it was counted unto Abraham for righteousness because he believed God. And the Hebrew word is he amened God. And of course in Hebrew it's amen, but he just amened God. He believed God, he agreed with God, because when you say amen, what is it there you're doing when you're saying amen? I agree with that. Most people are agreeing with doctrinal ideas that they themselves have never lived. They just know it's right because it's in the Bible and God, the Holy Spirit's with them and bears witness with their spirit, but they've never really lived it. They've never really moved into it because they've never really had a desperate hunger for the Holy Ghost now, for heaven now, for a greater glory now. And let me tell you something. That keeps getting bigger. In other words, the hunger and passion that I had 20 years ago, God met with many wonderful events over the past 20 years. But what has happened is every time in those movings of God, all that has happened is I've tasted of the heavenly gift. I've tasted, hallelujah, and made partakers of the Holy Ghost. I've tasted the good word of God and of His power. And I'm telling you, I want more. This is good eats. This is good. This is a good table. I want more. Come on, don't sit there and look at me like that, because I'm going to come and I'm going to bring a ministry of deliverance to you. Because I don't want to just see you. I don't want to see you sitting in sorrow and sighing anymore. Too many people, we talk about these things, and you know, and the whole time in the meeting, they're just sitting there looking like they weren't even saved. And then after the meeting, oh, Pastor, I agree with everything you say. Praise God. It's just so good to know God like this. And I'm thinking to myself, my goodness, I thought you were lost. Because the expression on your face, just, of course, I didn't say that, but the expression on your face is 99% of your testimony. Hello. Maybe you could write that one down as a note. Go ahead, write that down as a note, and go ahead, tattoo it to somewhere on your body that you can see. Just tattoo it somewhere on your body, rather than put in a little post-it note on your mirror or on your window or on your mirror, your cupboard in your kitchen, the places where you go most often, right? Just tattoo it somewhere where you can see it. Can you do that? Your expression is 99% of your testimony. Come on now. And we don't want you to have a testimony about how you're going through it again. How the devil's attacking you. How you single-handedly are fending off all the powers of darkness. I mean, you got to understand, why would they be attacking you anyway? You know, think about it. People are not hardly doing anything in the kingdom. I'm not saying this to you, because I'm probably, in Jesus' name, everyone is doing a lot in the kingdom. There's so many people, they're not doing much of anything. And they act like they're single-handedly having to deal with all this onslaught of the power of darkness. Why? No. What all is going on is you focused on the wrong realm. You need to get focused over here on the heavenly realm. It's not looking unto the enemy of your soul, huh? But it's looking unto the author and finisher of your faith. Hallelujah. Come on. Hallelujah. It's looking to the goodness of God. It's praising and it's worshiping and it's giving thanks. It's knowing who He is to you and for you. He's before you and behind you. He surrounds you with His love. He fills you with His glory. Being just caught away in this, that your enemies are defeated about you. That all those problems and all those issues go away. Get out of your stuck, because it ain't that big of a deal. Amen. What you made is some huge, gigantic thing is just you holding on to it. And when you release it to God's control, a miracle can happen. Hallelujah. When you just say, God, I'm living under the reign of your spirit. Hallelujah. Living under the reign. That's R-E-I-G-N. Reign of His spirit. And I'm living under the R-A-I-N. Reign. Hallelujah. Of His spirit. Ha-ha. Hallelujah. 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 And it's no cloudy days. It's just a cloud of glory. Huh? It's not like you guys say, well, we're living in the rain. It's all cloudy and we're all depressed because it's like living up in, you know, on the west coast of Washington, Oregon. It's just always rainy and cloudy. No, this is good. This is the cloud of God's glory falling down. Falling. It's happening right now. Some people are just
cloud, rain, spirit, me, God, love, joy, complex.
Think. Others are just going ahead and receiving what God is doing. Hallelujah. Because if you don't meet with God today, you came for nothing. You came for nothing. What I say don't make any sense at all. What I do is irrational. It is just like you came for nothing. But I'm telling you right now, if you could just begin to participate, if everybody in here who's been saved longer than 1 month, longer than 1 day, could begin to participate with the Holy Ghost, if the atmosphere of that participation and that agreement would begin to be so filled with divine power and glory. As long as people are around and stuck in the human realm, all there's going to be for the most part is the human realm influence. And that's why you walk into many churches and it's like you want to walk back out because all it is the human realm influence. But I'm telling you right now, when I walk in, I'm just saying I'm bringing the glory into this place. And this morning I walked in here and I'm bringing the glory of God into this place. It doesn't matter how many frowned looks. It don't matter how many sorrowful faces. It don't matter how much doubt and unbelief, how much wondering and issues there are among the people. We got a whole bunch of drink in here. Amen. We just want you to take a drink. How hard is it to receive from heaven? Drink? How hard is it for you to drink? You got to think about it. How am I going to drink this? Well, if I put this in my body, I wonder what's going to happen when it goes into my body. Well, and you got to figure out all the physiological mechanisms, and then you got to figure out how it's going to be metabolized. Goodness gracious, people, nobody does that. Nobody in their right mind does that. Why would we do it with God? Just go ahead and drink. Thank you. One. Two and a half. Three, four. Five, six and a half, seven. Whoa, this is pretty good. This is pretty good. Eight, nine. Hallelujah. Woo, make it 10. Hallelujah. Just so many equipata. Now this is about a day. Now, if I could just get you to just stay right there. Hallelujah. Just stay right there. The expressions of God will begin to grow and increase in your life. Just stay right there. Just stay happy. Hallelujah. Stay happy. Stay really emotional with God. Just stay emotional with him. Just go ahead, drink. Huh? Because you understand, with joy, you draw water from the well of salvation. With joy, hallelujah. With J for Jesus, joy. With joy. Don't look around. We're not looking around. Looking up, looking unto him. Hallelujah. Now open up your Bibles to 1 John 5 and verses 14 and 15. I'm going to begin to help you understand why you got to get out of you. Because otherwise, what's going to happen is all the things and all the promises of God are not going to be effective in your life. I'm going to ask you this question. How many of you, every time you ask God for something, he does it? Raise your hand. Every time you ask God for something, he does it. Okay? Then I want you to ask him for rain right now. Ask him for rain right now. Please, go ahead. I want to see the rain. Now, I want to ask one more time. Every time you ask God for something, he does it. I want you to raise your hand. Okay? Because I'm going to put it on you. I'm going to have you come up here and bring some fire down out of heaven for me. I'm going to have you do a couple of exploits and miracles for me. Because the realm is available, but give me a break. Not everybody or very few people have entered into this realm. Otherwise, we'd see the miracles in the ministry of Jesus. Everything that Jesus asked the Father to do, Father did it for him. Jesus stand before the tomb of Lazarus. He says, Father, I know that you hear me, that you always hear me, but for their sakes, I'm going to go ahead and say this out loud. Lazarus, come forth. And the dead raises. Come on now. I want everybody to move into the realm of what I'm talking about right now. When you ask Father for a miracle, when you ask God to begin to do something, he does it for you every time, no matter what scale it is. I'm not talking about anything other than the miracle ministry of Jesus, the works of Jesus, and greater works than these. And I'm trying to bring you into a realm of cooperating with the Holy Ghost so you can have this, because this is what Father is busy doing. Father is busy working with us, pleading with us to come into this realm, and this realm is a realm of intimacy. This realm is a realm of relationship that is centered around dwelling in his love, feeling and experiencing his love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. God is love. Knowing and believing the love that God has for us and allowing that love to be expressed through us to all of the brethren. Are you listening to me? Huh? Just giving yourself to say, look, anything opposite of this, anything that doesn't look like this, feel like this, is my enemy, and I'm going to resist it steadfast in the faith. And the way I'm going to be able to effectively resist it is I'm going to submit myself to the Holy Ghost, and I'm going to begin to feel the love. And somebody said, well, how do I plug into that? Praise and thanksgiving. God has said it over and over and over and over again. Joy and rejoicing. Hallelujah. He's my glory, hallelujah, and the lifter of my head. He's my joy and my rejoicing. He's my light and he's my life. We begin to grab a hold of the reality of these things. We begin to sing about them. We begin to praise in the midst of them. Our praise is about hooking up with a greater manifestation of the moving of God and the power of God and the glory of God. Some people train musicians to say, look around, and the more people are singing and participating, that's what you want to ultimately use as your indicator as to whether or not you're doing this praise and worship right. No, that is entirely wrong. All you want to be doing is to begin to experience, and the only indicator you want is a greater manifestation of his presence and of his glory. I'm here to teach you this morning about how to move into a fellowship with God that is an abundant life, a place where you walk in a baptismal anointing of the Holy Ghost, where God is able to perfect everything that concerns you, where you love righteousness and hate iniquity, and as a result, you're overwhelmed with the oil of joy, hallelujah, where you're living in a continual communion that is so beautiful and so wonderful that you don't want to do anything to compromise that, to in any way negatively affect that, for it to diminish at all. You want an increase. I want more of this. And you came into the meeting, I want more of this. You didn't come into the meeting with all the things that produces. and as a result of? Huh? The sorrow and the sighing and the affliction and the question and the can't answer it and reasons why and all those things. Why don't I get what I want? Why is it I seem so aloof from God? Why is it that He seems so far away from me? That's doubt and unbelief. And there's no way possible for any person who allows that to happen in their life to be able to receive anything from God. Now, if I categorized you into a place of you're in a place, dear friend, that you cannot receive anything from God, wouldn't you be very happy if I told you how to get out of that realm of you can't receive anything from God like that? Wouldn't you be very happy with me? Yeah, you would be. I could bring you over here and say, now you stay right over here because this is the realm in which you can receive things from God. If I help you understand, without faith, it's impossible to please Him, and you want to be able to please Him because that's the whole thing that is going on in your life, and your faith is all about what Jesus did for you and not what you did for Jesus. It's all about what God the Holy Ghost wants to do through you and not what you're going to do through the Holy Ghost. Can you hear me? Now you're in a family. You got a dad who loves you. It's not a dysfunctional family. Wonder if Dad likes me today. Hope I don't wake up and he's hollering and mad. I wonder if we're going to get any food today. Total dysfunctional. You don't know if you come out of the room whether you're going to get blessed or slapped across the head. Are you hearing me over here?
Yes.
Are you hearing me over here?
Yes.
It's about time God's people quit living like that. Yes. That ain't the way Father is. That ain't the way the household is. Hallelujah. And you're never going to step into God through your own efforts of performance. It ain't about your performance and how great and how grand you are. There's no A's and F's here. I know that's your whole framework of thinking is getting an A or getting an F. Achieving something that everybody else is really amazed about. Or just totally being a flop. You know, where every part of your being looks a little bit, you know, out of kilter and not moving properly. This is not the way the kingdom of God is. The way of kingdom of God is, His Father just loves us and He's brought us into this place of being accepted and beloved, and He wants us to come and enjoy this realm of relationship with Him. So why don't you do that? Because as soon as you do, you will move out of condemnation into acceptance, and suddenly you will move out of that sorrow, depressed look of failure, and you'll start living in joy and rejoicing, and then you'll begin to have a flow of the Holy Ghost in your life that is a relationship realm where you can feel the love and the joy, and it's just a continual supply there on a level that just grows, and it looks just like God and is an expression of heaven. And out of that realm, miracles and signs and wonders begin to take place. There's no condemnation there. There's no shame there. There's no guilt there. There's no asking questions there. They're just worshiping Him and thanking Him for all that He's done there. I'm going to get you out of the doubt. I'm going to get you out of the wavering. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, if your heart condemns you, then you're not going to have confidence towards God. You understand that? You're not going to have confidence towards God. 1 John chapter 3, verse 21, 20 and 21. You're not going to have confidence towards God. Huh? Then somebody said, well, what am I going to do? Get out of this condemned heart. You need to get over in the blood of Jesus and get washed in the blood. And then you need to lay hold on God and say, Holy Spirit, I want to understand how to walk in your strength, in your power, in your authority. So people have learned how to go to the Lord Jesus and say, hey, praise God, Father has provided for me a cleansing in the blood. Isn't that wonderful? And I'm telling you, if you'll just begin to really, truly believe that, you'll immediately get happy. You won't have to go through, you won't have to walk up the stairs of broken glass, go through some series of penance, some series of, you know, beating yourself and smacking yourself upside the head, huh? Or maybe pounding your head up against the wall till you got a bump and now you feel like you've suffered enough. Get somebody to come and spank you or whatever. Your cure is in the blood. Your healing, your cleansing is in the blood. You're not penance, but repentance. Hallelujah. 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 God has granted unto us the gift of repentance. a complete change of life. And then in that, he has given to us forgiveness of sins. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. A repentance took place when you became born again. Praise God. And praise God for godly sorrow that brings you to repentance. To say, wait a minute. If I've allowed myself to go back to the former life, God has given me the gift now of the Holy Spirit working with me, godly sorrow, to come back and now begin to walk with him the way I'm supposed to walk with him. And there, walking in the light as he's in the light, walking in the love as he's in the love, walking in the joy as he's in the joy, the blood of Jesus Christ continually cleanses us from all sin. And there I find myself in this wonderful place of knowing and believing the love that God has for me. And I find there is no condemnation, because I'm walking in the Holy Ghost. I'm relying upon the Holy Ghost, because that's the part that so many people fail to recognize. They come to the blood for cleansing, and they need to, and that's where we come. The blood of Jesus Christ for cleansing. But we come to the Holy Spirit to rely upon him to have the ability and have the strength, hallelujah, to be taught, to understand, to know how to do these things. I can't know them of myself. He fills me with the hunger. I can't get hunger for myself. He fills me with the thirsting. I can't get thirsting for myself. He fills me with the ability to hate iniquity. I can't do that on my own. He's given me that wisdom and that insight. It comes from him, and I want it, and I lay hold on it. I'm not willing to allow things to go on as they've been going on. I'm looking for not my answers, but his answers. I've come to rely upon his provision for me, his protection for me. Come on, people. Without faith. And I understand demonic powers that would try to muddle that and confuse that. And I'm going to tell you right now, what you got to do is you got to quit trying to figure it out. And you got to go to just worshiping. Somebody said, how do you do it? I worship. I have people around me, hands around me all the time. I worship. I praise them. I don't get trapped in this and that and the other thing. I just worship. I just praise him. I just believe in a big God.
Amen.
Who's empowered me to go do great things.
Yes.
In his kingdom. Who's first and foremost empowered me to be able to interact with him. You can't interact with God and walk out of that place with a frown and sorrow and sickness and disease and turmoil in your life. You cannot. You need to dance. Hallelujah. We were over there in Oregon on Wednesday night, and I tell you, it doesn't matter where I'm at, even if the music isn't right, I'll change the music. I'll just grab a hold of a move of God, have a move of God, and I was getting ready to minister. I was like, then I didn't really have an opportunity to dance much. I said, I just got to dance first. I had to dance around for a while, let everybody stand and stare at me. But what happens, before long, as they're staring first, it's awkward, and then all of a sudden they're feeling something they never felt before.
Amen.
What is this? What is this I'm feeling? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. What is this? It's life. It's abundant life. It's like electricity, isn't it? It's a thrill, isn't it?
Yes.
It's tasting of the heavenly gift. So, you know, people used to wonder, sit around wondering, question, try to figure out, how do we taste the heavenly gift? How are we made partakers of the Holy Ghost? How do we taste the good word of God and the power of the worlds to come? Come on, give me a break. Just start worshiping him. Start praising him. Start giving thanks for what he did for you at Calvary.
Amen.
Come and worship at the altar of Calvary.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come worship at the altar of his throne, of the holies of holies. It's his throne. I worship at the altar of his throne. Huh? My access is through the cross, the veil of Jesus' body where it was broken. That's my altar. I walk in. Hallelujah. I walk into the veil of his flesh, through the altar of sacrifice at Calvary. And that's, you know, it's like walking in that first door, that first gate. And the next thing I see is this radiant glory of his enthroned presence in the Holy of Holies. And I hear him say, hey, come in. Come in here. Get in here right now. My friend, where have you been? And I don't want him to be saying, where have you been? But if you're in a place today where you feel like that you've not been in that communion, he's like, that's what you're going to get from him. You're not going to get condemnation. He's going, hey, come in. Peace to those who are near and to those far away. Come in. Where have you been? Yeah, I'm going to tell you right now, some of you, I can't wait to see you in heaven. I've been so earnestly longing to see those expressions here on earth. And we haven't been able to get them out of you. Praise God, you're faithful and you keep coming. And I'm so blessed to see you. different people have on their cars, taxi cab to heaven. Bless you. Father is going to bless you. He's going to give you souls. Hallelujah. He's going to give you souls. I promise you, God's going to give you souls. Hallelujah. He's looking for some obedient people, not brilliant people. God's not looking for brilliant people. He's looking for obedient people. He's not looking for golden vessels and silver vessels. He's looking for empty vessels. He's not looking for people who got it all figured out. He's looking for people who are needy and who want him, whose life, they're not satisfied with their own life and they want his life. That's all Father's looking for. So he goes, because if you think what you got is good, I'm telling you right now, you deceived. If you think what you can produce is good, I'm telling you right now, you've been lied to all your life and it has taken hold. Are you listening to me? Been lied to all your life, and now it has literally become the very conscious state of your being, your existence. People, I'm here to tell you how to hate your life in this world. I'm here to show you how to lose your life so you can have his life. Amen. And that's all about you being able to behold his glory, because as soon as you begin to behold his glory, you go, you mean I can have that? And you're going to divest yourself real quickly of you and run grab the robe he's got for you. Amen. You're going to be saying, they're not going to be looking around going, well, I don't know. I really like this one. I really like this coat. You're not going to be doing that. Huh? You're not going to be wondering, should I be hanging on to my life? I mean, there's a couple of things I really like to do. You're going to see that beauty. You're going to see that glory. Amen. You ain't going to go out no more. No. You're never going to go out no more. Hallelujah. You're going to begin to understand. Well, for many of you, God has tried to seed you over and over again by just describing to you what happened with Moses. God tries to seed us with what took place with other people, saying, what I've done for one, I'll do for you. That's all he's doing. He's seeding us. He's not trying to get us to just sit there and go, man, I wish I could be that too. He's seeding us because he wants us to know that he's no respecter of persons. That what he's done for one, he'll do for you. And now he's brought us into a greater glory. He's brought us into a greater economy. He's brought us into a greater intimacy. He's brought us into a place of being able to see more, know more, do more, and fully represent him and not go to his tabernacle, but be his tabernacle. Come on, people. Come on, people. Come on. Don't sit there with that intellectual head of yours trying to figure out what I'm saying. You got to grab this with your heart because you're longing to have it. When you long to have the things of God, you're not trying to think it through. You're not trying to run through your various, categories of Scripture. Huh? Going through your little catalog. Your little limited mind catalog. God's so much bigger than our catalogs. Of what we think we know, the way that we've wrongly, in many instances, connected verses of Scripture. And are convinced we're right, and all we did was entangle ourselves, and that's why we're not moving forward. Huh? And Father's earnest about this. Because he's always been human resource limited. He's looking for some people to come and do this stuff. Come on. Come on. He's looking for some people to be empowered. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm empowered, man. Hallelujah. He's looking for people to find all their worthiness and all their deserving. I deserve this. Why? Because I'm in Jesus and he's in me. It's agreement with God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. Praise the name of Jesus. Can I have your Bible? Is it two type? 2 point? That's not bad. It's not 2 point type, it's 3. Hallelujah. We're just moving on up in faith to be able to see 3 point. Amen. We're growing in faith. I'm growing and maturing in God's disposition. I'm not going to stay in the disposition I had last week. I'm determined to lay hold on God. I'm determined. I laid hold on eternal life. Eternal life is the life of God, the expressions of God. It's the life of Jesus. It's the life of the Holy Spirit. I'm laid hold on. I'm going to have a greater expression of his love and feel a greater expression of his love. I'm going to have a greater expression of his joy and feel a greater expression of his joy. Because I'm going to have and experience a greater intimacy with Him. I'm going to see faith grow. I'm going to see knowledge and understanding and revelation of who He is grow and mature in my life. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's why I constantly stare at the Word of God. Because there is a development of all of that taking place, because His Word is spirit in His life. It's supernatural. It's more powerful than some sorcerer or witch doctor doing some incantation with some word to put some Houdini on somebody.
Come on.
But everybody's really certain that the Houdini is going to work. Huh? Somebody cast a spell upon me. They didn't need to. You already spellbound. But nonetheless, somebody cast a spell upon me. No problem. I'm greater in authority and power than any of those sorcerers or doctors. I release you from it. They had to sit around and work it up for a month. I can do it, and I'm going to undo everything they did. They had to work so hard to create for an entire month in 1 second. In fact, I just come into the room and it's gone. Hallelujah. Why? I have confidence in God. I have confidence not in me. I have a vote of no confidence in me. I am not sufficient of myself. My confidence is in God, the one, the greater one who's in me. It's not about me. It's not about my performance. It's not about what I can do or what I have done. Can you get this?
Yeah.
It is a place of liberation. It's a place of freedom. It's a place of release.
Amen.
And you know that you got it when you start praising. You know that it sure is when you start going to worship and the dance comes on. I'm telling you, I promise you, don't you tell me that it doesn't, that you're unique and somehow you don't get affected that way. Every one of us get affected the same way when the same Spirit of God moves on us. Hallelujah. I don't care what culture, what background, what genealogy, don't matter. There's one Spirit has one, produces one kind of effect. Hallelujah. All you're doing is talking to me about your spirit. When people say, oh, we're not that way. We're really sorrowful and sad by nature. That's your spirit. That's your spirit. God wants to change that spirit. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And He has, but then Satan comes, lies to people, they get back under that grip of that thing. And now it's the determination of your will to say, no, I'm yielded to the Holy Ghost. And I know exactly what He's doing. I don't ever have to wonder, are you mad today? Are you depressed today so that I can agree with you and be depressed too? Are you sad today? Are you upset today? Are you complaining today? Are you like full on going to do strife all day and arguments? No one has to even think that way. You don't have to try to figure out what God's doing. He's made Himself known of who He is. He's doing life. He's doing what you, if you have a choice, you want to be around. Huh? Nobody in there with the choice wants to go around where everybody's fussing and fighting and arguing with each other. Right? All one out of here. Right? Is that true?
Yes.
Come on. That's God the Holy Ghost. That's what He wants. And that's the choice He wants us to make about us individually. What is it like to be around me? Come on. Come on, what you have to think about it. You have to ask the question, what is it like to have to live with me? I want God to come live with me. And then He says, listen, I'll take care of that. Huh? I know some people are so full of narcissism. It's a demonic word. It's a demonic thing. That they think everything about themselves is wonderful and beautiful and amazing and excellent and glorious. And they sit and stand there and, you know, look themselves in the mirror. It's hard to break away. They don't have time to watch TV. They're too busy looking themselves in the mirror. This demonic thing, man. I couldn't imagine. Could you imagine? There's whole books written on what it's like to live with a narcissist. And I think there's libraries on what it's like to live with a narcissist, a narcissistic person. And I think it would be good for people to read. I mean, it's muddled with all kinds of nonsense, but it would be good for people to read that and go, am I like that? Because you're on a venture, you know, you're on a quest to hate your own life in this world. Huh? You're on a quest to start denying yourself. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
What if He just loved you? Why just love me? I'm just so, why just love me? I love my love me. I'm just so good to be around, and you're just miserable. That is a stronghold, isn't it? And the only way you can break free from that is to step into His glory and see how wonderful it is to be around Him. And then you go, you mean I could be like that? He said, yeah, well, the only way you can stay in here is if you're willing to be like this. Because, you know, all the doubters and all the complainers are out. All the strife makers and all the people who want to live in division and envy, they're out. You can't come in. Well, I want in. I want in. I'll be conformed to you then. I'll do it your way. I'll learn how to walk like you, step like you, move like you, laugh like you, rejoice like you, love like you. Ha ha! Feel like you. Come on. This is what the Bible breaks down into. This is what the Word of God breaks down into. It's not all these religious concepts and religious ideas and notions. It's just simply engaging in this beautiful, wonderful life.
Start worshiping.
Come on, start worshiping. Not because you have to, but because you are just so blessed by what He's done. And that being blessed by what He's done for you, not worshiping so you can get something, but that worshiping that comes as a result of the Holy Ghost being there and you recognizing what He's done for you, that your name's written in the book of life, that your sins have been washed away, that God has commended His love to you. Just those wonderful basic things begin to produce a worship and begin to produce a praise and begin to produce a thanksgiving. And then that takes you to another dimension of praise and another dimension of worship. And it takes you to a deeper utterance, into a broader expression, into a wider, into a longer intimacy and interaction with Him. You're stuck in, I haven't reached anybody for Jesus, and I prayed, nothing happened, and my toe's been aching now for 3 months, and it just hurts worse every time I pray. I'm just going to quit praying because it just gets worse. I'm going to just quit asking God for anything so I won't be disappointed. No, it just goes on. It just goes on. It's a state. It's a state. It's a mental state that people live in. People just don't like me over there. I'm not going over there. I don't care if the glory of God is there. I'm not going over there. Did you hear what I just said?
Yeah.
I'm not going. I don't care if the glory of God's. I don't care if the glory of God's over there. I'm not going over there because people just don't like me over there. They just don't want me to be around. True. Then your desires towards man, not God.
Yes.
True. If the glory of God's there, you don't care what's there, man. You won't bust you all. I'm getting past all this stuff. I don't care if people walking on top of me, stomping on me, don't even recognize that I'm there, kicking me in the ribs while I'm crawling towards Jesus. Hey? It's a woman with the issue of blood. Do you hear me? It's a woman with the issue of blood. She wasn't allowed to be there. It was against the law for her to be there. She had an issue of blood. She was not allowed to be in the congregation under peril of being stoned to death. The crowd was great and she was weak because of that issue of blood that she had had for so many years. Come on now. Could you imagine if everybody went to church like that? Come on. I've got a need and I know where to find Him. He's there standing in the midst of His church. People don't like that. They want to just do it in their living room. It's in the midst of His church. In the midst of His church, all this wonderful thing that God has given and released to us that have been born again resides and there is distributed as the church is the manifestation of the very person of His only begotten Son, Jesus. Come on. This is what I want. This is what I'm desperate for. Why? Because I have the Spirit of the Son in me. I have the will of the Father burning on the inside of me. And this is what Father wants for His church. This is what He wants expressed in the midst of His people. All this other stuff is nonsense. It makes no sense at all. It has no meaning. It has no value. It's self-serving. A self-interest. Of people's own wants and desires and wills, and God saying, will you come and connect with mine? And then all of a sudden, you want to begin to step into a move of God now, a Holy Ghost power, wellspring now, a Holy Ghost river now, Holy Ghost glory now, the expression of heaven now. becomes an all-consuming fire, which is a synonym for desire. I was baptized in the desire of Almighty God when I was baptized in the fire. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, I got happy. Hallelujah. Oh, yeah, I got full of love. Yes. Oh, I was overwhelmed by peace. Peace is what? Condemnation can't come anywhere near peace. You got condemnation, you need peace. Jesus said, I'll give you my peace. And he said, gave me assignment. Said, you go to any house, and if that house is worthy, you let your peace come upon that house. You release it. Wow, what God has vested in you and I, the opportunity that he's vested in us, this wonderful thing that he wants to express through us and the dynamics of the relationship for which he has chosen and elected us, that we bring forth this kind of fruit, that this is the product and the expression of our life, that whatever we ask him, he will do it. That's the fruit that God wants produced. What stops that fruit? Cares of this life, deceitfulness of riches, people's own selfish interests and identity and their own pursuit for their own greatness, false motivations, wrong decisions. It chokes the word of God so it can't bring forth this fruit that God wants. You hearing me?
Yes.
Come on, people. It's just, God's Father has something for us that's far better than anything you can pick in this earth, and we want to be able to convince you of this, because if we don't have a couple of people to agree with us, where is there going to be an expression of divine power and glory? If we don't have a couple of people that will camp around the will of God and camp around the expressions of the Spirit of the living God, then there is going to be no witness in the earth.
Yes.
And all we're going to do is repeat over and over again the same kind of message to people who have been born again, who are loved by God but don't know how to respond to the cry of the Spirit. And I pray today that every one of you, you begin to live in the hunger and the thirsting of the move of the Holy Ghost now, a greater manifestation of heaven and the glory and the power of God. It will change the dynamics of how you have to deal with sin and death and temptation and choices. Oh, hallelujah. And you won't have to be sitting around all sorrowful and all pained and all overwhelmed.
Amen.
Because you got a confidence.
Yes.
You know, now all you did was hook up with the will of God. Now all you're doing is demanding of yourself what God commanded. That's all that's going on. Understand, I'm a revivalist. I'm a person that causes people by the Spirit of the Lord to press in to a greater demonstration and outworking of the Spirit of the Lord. And too many people, I've had thousands of people go through this ministry. Thousands of people have gone through this ministry because so many people just want to be left alone. They found their own interest. They found their own equilibrium in life, and they do not want to be pushed to more. They don't want the press. They just want, they're so insecure. They just got to every moment have somebody say, yeah, you're doing good now. Yeah, you're still doing good. Yes, you're still. Can I leave for just a second? Because I go over here and tell somebody else they're doing good. And this is the pastoral ministry. Yes, you're doing good. Just hold that thought for a minute. I'll be right back. And you're doing really good, too. And I'm just so blessed and so happy that you're here. Are you still doing okay? Okay, I'm back over here. Pastoral ministries. Not me. I want you to find your confidence in God. I want you to find your approval in him. I'm going to tell you right now, in love, there is no insecurity. There is no fear. That insecurity has torment. That fear has torment. When you accept it, then beloved, it's just like, it don't even matter no more. You know what I'm saying? You're just going around accepting everybody. I've watched it over and again. I've gone into places and, as it were, hostile environments in the Christian community where, for example, you know, there's some kind of rumor going around, you know, that, you know, I'm teaching something terrible or this or that, and you walk into the room and you know everybody's looking at you strange, but you're not even influenced by it. You're just like there accepting everybody. You're not affected by it. Hey, so good to see you, you know. And it changes the whole atmosphere, and they're all like scratching their head when you walk out going, wow, that was a whole lot of love over there. It just, you don't come under all the things that are being thrown at you from people and from environments and from atmospheres and from demon spirits. You come to be segregated, separated, consecrated, yes, to a realm of God in relationship and intimacy and interaction with Him. And it's just like, bring it, Lord. Let that correction come, because I want more. Yeah. It doesn't have an effect of insecurity and failure and rejection. It's like, oh yeah, I'm going to go up to my high place and see what God has to say when He reproves me. When He straightens me out so I can just move in into a greater agreement with Him, into a greater flow, into a greater operation of that which He's doing and wants to do through my life. Because He's made me and you His representatives in the earth. Hallelujah. Woo! Yeah! Who wants to miss out on this?
Not me.
Who wants to live any other kind of life when we get to live His life, when we get to function in His ministry, in His vocation? Walk worthy of the vocation that you've been called unto with all lowliness and meekness. This wonderful realm of representing God. What do you do for a living? I represent God. Come on, let's disarm all, let's start doing it, let's start speaking it like it is, and disarm all the people with all the things that they have centered around the semantics of Christian vocabulary. Come on, people. It's time that the hungry and the thirsty say, quit saying, the people who are really serious and mean business with God say, I can't find a church to go to. I get there and it's just a bunch of people caught up in humanism, caught up in their own self-interest, caught up in religion. There's too many people like that out there. It's about time you start cooperating with the glory so the glory can be in the house in a greater way. It's time that you start being a revivalist instead of being those people who are in need of revival. What is revival? And I'm going to tell you right now, I have this for revival churches. This is a revival church.
Yes.
Because what happens, we get into a little expression and we just stay there. And we never move forward into the demonstration of what Father has for us. We don't understand that those events and those encounters with God were just about bringing us to a greater encounter. And it's not some kind of reckless pursuit and overwhelmed because, oh no, I still need to go after something more. You're captivated, man. It ain't even about that. It ain't even about that. It's about being overwhelmed with his presence, with His relationship, with His intimacy that you have in Him, about just giving yourself to the most beautiful, wonderful things called love and joy and His life and His goodness, hallelujah, and His heavenly disposition. And that results in you going into a greater display of His power and glory that He does through you, that you don't produce of your own efforts through your own striving. Amen. You learn how to rest. Yeah. You learn how to enter kurabah. Fearless, the promise of entering into His rest. Any of you should come short of it. Jesus says, come on over here and rest. Come on over here. Take hold of this life of mine, this lowliness and meekness, this place of only living to do the will of the Father. Hallelujah. This place, hallelujah, of not walking in self-interest and self-will, not walking in the pride of life, not walking in all the things that you need for yourself, but just, just being so occupied with serving everybody else. I can't think of a better way to express lowliness and meekness than being willing to be servant to everybody. Just so delighting to just serve everybody. Just bless everybody. Huh? You don't have to try to figure it out. You don't have to wonder about it, because when you allow God the Holy Ghost to inhabit your life, He'll just work it all out. See, God has made His desires my desires. I didn't make my desires conform. I didn't of myself make my desires His desires. He made my desires His desires, because I said, Lord, I want to do those things that are pleasing unto You. I want to love what You love, hate what You hate, desire what You desire, want what You want. The Lord says here to us in John 5, and I want you to understand that these are kind of concluding remarks to everything that John has said up to this point. He's bringing this thing to a conclusion. He's wrapping it all up. He's said, really saying, all that I've discussed and all that I've said now brings us to this place so that I can tell you what I've been wanting to say. And here's really one of those highlights when he says, beginning here in verse 13, he says, "These things have I written unto you that believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life." In other words, that you may know that you have sonship, that you have divine sonship, that you've been born again, you've been made a new creation, that God is your Father, you the habitation of God, the Holy Ghost. Because you just take eternal life, the best thing for you to do is take eternal life and replace eternal life with everything that eternal life means and how you got eternal life and what are the results of eternal life. And then you grab a hold of something far bigger than just a little concept. You grab a hold of the revelation of this wonderful good news of what it means to be born again. Hallelujah. Sonship. You think about this. I want you to just grab with me the sonship. The sonship that now has made us heirs and co-inheritors with God. The sonship that has brought us in to a divine empowerment to fully represent Him, to not be like a child anymore, but to be, as it were, a son that has matured enough to take over Father's business. Galatians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Wow, immediately empowered, entrusted. How are you going to ever begin to function in all of that unspeakable glory and that unspeakable blessing? You got to get yourself some confidence. You got to get yourself some confidence in God. How am I going to get confidence in God? You're going to have to start enjoying the relationship. You're going to have to start enjoying the fellowship. How am I going to enjoy the fellowship? You're going to have to believe what God said about His Son. Hallelujah. And who you are now. Don't make God a liar no more. Don't make Him untrustworthy no more. Don't bring Him into question anymore. Huh? Make your battlefront all those doubts and all those things contrary to what God has said with a shout. Hallelujah. Yeah. Let there be shoutings. Let there be trumpet blasts of praise within your life that shuts down all those harassing, tormenting lies that want to hold on you and drag you into hell now and into hell eternity, that claims that you are theirs. When God's saying, "No, you're mine. But you have to agree with me. You have to say yes." Hallelujah. You have to say yes. God wants to give you a confidence. He wants to give you a boldness. It's not a self-confidence, though. And self-confidence will run interference with this. It will pollute it. It will pollute the flow. It will pollute it. And you can't see with your own wisdom and understanding. It is a revelation that only God brings. And God wants to bring you to this revelation. He wants to bring you to a spirit of wisdom and revelation so that your eyes can be open spiritually, so that you don't live and rely upon the five senses. He wants to deliver you from the oppressive bondage and the stronghold of living out your life based on the five senses. And let you see what's really going on, that you stand before the living God, the God who hears. The God who sees. What a revelation. What a great confidence came into Hagar's life that day when it was suddenly revealed to her that she is the one whom God sees. He is the living. All of a sudden, God became to her not the God of Abraham, her master, but the Lord who sees me. Whoa! How about you get a revelation of God, the God who hears me, who sees me, who loves me, who feels me. Changes all the dynamics of your life instantly at that encounter.
Amen.
Only God, the Holy Spirit, can give you that. Yes. And He wants to. You have to ask Him. I said to some country people the other day, I said, "You acknowledge God all your ways, and what is He going to do?" And people started finishing the verse of Scripture. I said, "Let me just tell you in good layman country terms, He's going to take hold of you. He's going to take hold of you. Yeah. And He will not let go. And you will find yourself being everything which He's commanded, because He does it." Hallelujah. When you begin to work out your own salvation with fear and trembling, knowing that it's God who does the work on the inside of you. Hallelujah. It's God which worketh. It's God who wills and does of His good pleasure in the midst of us. Suddenly we take our own tools off of our life. We stop trying to be somebody and start getting a hold of what He's made us, and we begin to delight ourselves in all the wonderful things that God has done for us. For He's done something greater than bring us out of a land of Egypt, out of a bondage of slavery. He's brought us into this glorious light and this glorious life, having delivered us from the pains of death. Hallelujah. Oh, to grab a hold of the reality of God and faith. It changes the disposition of your life, and to hold on to it and not let go, but daily minister to Him like this. In thanksgiving for what He's done, exalting Him for His love, His grace, His honesty, His integrity. Hallelujah. Come on, people. It's a battlefront. The Father has strengthened us and given us the ability so that we're well able. Hallelujah. 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 You start wanting a greater encounter with God, I'm telling you, all the things that Satan tries to entice you with and throw at you and interest you with and preoccupy you with and draw you into in temporal pleasures will lose its power, because there's something greater you interested in. There's something more wonderful that you must have. Come on. Hallelujah. I'm living for the meeting. I live for the fellowship. I live for the relationships. True. When people have become so bonded together, they've been married for 70 years. We're just interacted with some people celebrating their 63rd anniversary. They live for the relationship, and when one dies, the other dies. Happens over and again. They're captivated by the relationship, the bond. I live for the encounter. I live for the meeting. I live for the fellowship. Ann and I were separated this past week, and all we did was, live to be back together. Just live to be back together. Waiting for that moment, waiting for that day. We could talk on the phone, that was good, but it wasn't good, Wasn't good enough. All week I lived for the meeting. All week I lived for the encounter. Hallelujah. Praise God. And she didn't come with her, you know, her work clothes on and her hair all in a bun with a scarf over her work scarf on. And her baseball cap. She came dressed up. Because she lived for the meeting. We lived for the meeting. Oh, just accept me for what I am. No. We understand that. We want you to understand something far greater. That you can begin to live for the meeting. That it begins to be expressed through your life. Through your actions, through your behavior. There's something more that God wants you to be able to see. So that response can be there in your life. It's not a legislated response. It's not somebody telling you, hey, you got to get dressed up. You got to look better when we meet. It's you. It's in you. It's in you. It's in your heart. It's in your being. It's in the fabric of your being. God's talking to you about the meeting. And He tells us then, He said, and that you may believe on the name of the Son of God. And understand, that's the place of authority, that sonship authority. As many as believed, listen, as many as received, He gave them authority to be the sons of God, as many as believed upon His name. Oh, see, John's got that wrapped right up. That's fully, this verse is so loaded with the message of the Gospel of John, the things that he's repeated over and over again, all about the intimacy, all about the relationship. It's not about mechanics. It's not about diagrams. It's not about building some kind of machine to discover something. It's about accepting what He's done. Hearing His word that produces something so supernatural on the inside of us called faith. Hallelujah. And then we read here, in view of this, and this is the confidence that we have in Him. In this kind of sonship place, this divine sonship place, this place where He's Father, we're children, where He's God, we're His people, this place of intimacy, this place where we're in Him, He's in us. Come on, I have this confidence. I don't have confidence in me, and this is the confidence that I have in him. Do you see that? And this is the confidence that we have. This is the confidence that I have in him. Not this is the confidence that I have in myself, that I'm now matured enough, and now I'm developed enough, and now I've proven enough, and I've shown God that I truly am, da, 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 da. This is the confidence that we have in him. That if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, see, this is another realm. This is no longer, listen to me, this is no longer living on the five senses, divining your life or trying to figure out your life based upon your experiences and your circumstances. It's another divine, huh? To divine is to try to get into the supernatural to figure something out, but it's all based upon, you know, the various omens, the various unique things that are happening to you. You define your life based upon what you see about you. How the peas settled in the bowl. How the coffee grounds settled in the bottom of the cup. You hear what I'm saying? How the bones landed on the table. How the dice rolled out. But I'm living, brother, by the word of God, his spirit and his life, his power and his glory. Something that works out the will of God effectually in my life. Where I can stand here and say, he is God who hears me. And if I know that he hears me, then whatever I ask him, he's going to do it. Hear how loaded this is, people, with relationship. Because John wrote John 15. He wrote John chapter 15. And he if you want expounding on this verse of scripture, you go look at John chapter 15, and Jesus is just simply saying, hey guys, I want you to be good enough to be accepted by me. Did you read that? Guys, look, I'm God, you're not. I want you to act good enough and be good enough to be accepted by me. He didn't say that. He said, come on in. He says, come and live with me. Hello, hello. Knock, knock. Is anybody home? Can I please open this door over here so we can have some fellowship? Banging on the door. Open the door, please. Would you please? Oh, God, where are you? Open the door. Oh, God, if I could just see you and know you. Hey! He's saying, can you hear me? He's saying, come and dwell in me, and I'll dwell in you. Come live in me. Come. He's saying, my Father is the husbandman, and I am the vine, and you're the branches. Come. Live in me. If you live in me, and my words can live in you and dominate you and be the instruction of your life, ask whatever you will. It's yours. He says it over and over and over again. And I'm going to close now with this, and I'm going to come back at it, hit it harder tonight. And moving in the realms of faith. But relationship and faith are inseparable. Faith is a product of the relationship. True. Let me just give you an example how this works. Okay? Last time I was here, when was it? Last Sunday night. The glory of God was so strong. I know there's people who don't experience it because you don't really understand or know how to. But we're here to teach you. I'm standing over here just overwhelmed with the Spirit of the Lord. My wife had injured her back. She was in intense pain for a couple of days. So I walked over here. She's standing right there. And I hugged her. She immediately got healed.
Yeah. Immediately.
Every bit of pain. That's why she started crying, just at intense pain, suddenly released. Why? Because these miracles, it isn't all the things that we try to make them happen in. It's in the love. It's in the expressions of his love. And first you got to feel that, because you can't make that happen. You can't create that. God comes in response to our willingness to walk and move with him and brings that. Hallelujah. Our willingness to have it, because he's poured it out. I can't help it that people have violated things in the spirit. They violated relationship with God and are stuck and not able as it seems to experience that love. I'm here to bust you out of prison. But you can't sit there in a jail and say, I'm fine. We're good. I'm okay. I don't know why he's hollering at me. We're hollering at you, man, because the place is burning down around you. Because you're in prison. And we want you to come over here and enjoy the goodness. But then to come and enjoy the fellowship. I can't believe he's hollering. He's hollering. He's fussing. He must not like us. Love you. Love you. Don't want you to live that way no more. Willing to die for you so that you won't live that way anymore. That's what Jesus did. I'm willing to lay down my life for you so you don't live that way anymore. I'm willing to suffer a cruel beating, mocking, rejection, so that you don't live that way anymore. I'll go through whatever it takes. I'll go to hell for you, Jesus said, so you don't have to live that way anymore. And I'll go in and I'll overthrow every power of hell while I'm there. Hallelujah. So you won't have to live that way anymore. And I'll raise up from the dead with the keys of death and hell so you don't have to live that way anymore. I'll do whatever it takes so you don't have to live that way anymore. I'll plead with you. I'll bang on your door. I'll stand there knocking. I'll wrestle with you. I'll plead with you so you don't have to live that way anymore. Now all I gotta do is just accept it. And accept it in a way to where that all of a sudden God looks in the heart and says, ah, I can come with all my glory and fill you. Hallelujah. This is what the Lord wants to do. This is what he's purposed to do for us. And you know, the Lord broadens it. Whatsoever you will. Whatsoever you will. Whatever you ask me, I will do. That the Father may be glorified. And we find that whatsoever we ask, because we find that in the context of living out his life, being consumed with his interest. People live in their homes with children who are lost and don't know God, and they don't know how to take a hold of the power and the authority of the Spirit to release them from their sin. They try to educate them out of their sin. I'm not going to get into verse 16, but that's really the power that has been given. I can, with that prayer, but being able to ask God whatever I want, and he'll do it. I can release people from their sin. Hallelujah. So we can't hold them and trap them. You're just stuck. Father's inviting you to come into a fellowship with him of divine authority. The only begotten Son has made a way for you and I to be sons. Hallelujah. Careful, son. Don't draw me over. Come with me. Let me have that Bible. Mark 11:24. I don't want to be sorrowful. I don't want to be sad. I don't want to be lonely. I want to be happy. Hallelujah. Mark 11:24. Look at me. Just joy and rejoicing. Hallelujah. Just joy and rejoicing. Just joy and rejoicing. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now I pray in the name of Jesus, every person in this place is going to begin to make a shift. If you look at revivals, there's constantly moves of God making shifts. I love to go back and look at the history of songs as they make shifts, as they press in. And you'll just study songs, study praise that were born in the Spirit. Oh, making those shifts. I'm not going to live. You're not going to get me to live in the same kind of relationship and dynamic. I will not. I'm going to grow. I'm going to mature. I'm going to press in for more. It's going to be deeper. It's going to be broader. It's going to be longer. Hallelujah. It's going to be more glorious. It's going to come out of heaven. I'm not going to get stuck. Why? Because I'm pressing in for a realm of heaven. I'm pressing in for something that is beyond all the other dynamics of what people would try to make a walk with God to be. It's just simply intimacy with him. That's it. That's it. I'm under no obligation to reach a single soul for the kingdom. I'm under obligation to love him with all of my heart and with all my soul and with all that is within me, to know him, to know God. Out of that will come all the rest. It's true. Out of that. And if you try to go after the other, then it's religious. It's earning salvation. It's trying to earn a place and position with God. It's trying to earn acceptance. Father's given it to us. He's given us this. This is the mystery of the fellowship. He looks at us and everything about our life is acceptable. Everything is holy. Everything is pure. Everything is righteous. He says, come on in. Our sin and our iniquity remembers no more. And he invites us into a place now where we're free to be matured and developed through interaction with him. We cannot grow and mature and be developed in God unless we have this intimate interaction with him, this fellowship, this dialogue, this conversation, this interaction. We can't. So he made a way with the blood of Jesus Christ, with the death, burial, and resurrection. So that you and I could be accepted in the beloved. He made a new creation, everything that is pleasing unto God. Hallelujah. So we can come on in. Hallelujah.
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 More of Jesus. Do more of Jesus. Mark chapter 11, verse 24. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire, whatever you want, I'll do whatever you want. And fellowship says, Father, I'll do whatever you want. I'll do whatever you ask me. He says, whatever you ask me, I'll do it. I say, Father, whatever you ask me, I'll do it. Well, I want you to fully represent me. I want you to be conformed to my image. I want you to come on in over here into the holies of holies. And I want you to be empowered by me to do signs and wonders and miracles. You used to get over here in this place of love where there is no fear, where there is no condemnation, and signs and wonders and miracles will begin to happen in your life. You get over this place where you understand the wisdom of how to move in love and move in joy, hallelujah, and move in thanksgiving, and miracles happen without effort. I love telling people about the story of these Chinese women who came to the meeting in China, and all these women had sicknesses and diseases, and none of one of them were getting healed. Suddenly the Lord said, their sickness and their disease stands between me and them. I said to the women, I said, all of you love Jesus, and I know that. So I just want you to forget about being healed, and I just want you to just worship him and praise him for what he's done for you at the cross of Calvary. Every one of you, you know you're saved. You know that you've been born again. You know that you're the children of the living God. You know that your name's written in the Lamb's Book of Life, and you're on the way to heaven. I just want you to begin to worship him for who he is. And as they did, they began to be healed. God gives us wisdom. He gives us revelation. He gives us understanding. But sometimes we got to, because we have been so integrated into a world that is so opposite, we have to learn simple lessons of relationship over and over and over and over again. It is so easy to walk in divine health, and I break the yoke of the lie that says it isn't. It is so easy to walk in divine joy, and I break the yoke and the lie that says it isn't. It's so easy to release people from their sins, and I break the yoke and the lie that says it isn't. God has given us the authority to turn men from darkness to light, from the power of Satan to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's amazing. Will you worship him because he's amazing? Will you worship him because he loves you so much? Will you let your face be conformed to his goodness?
Yes.
Will you start with the expressions of your heart? If you're hanging on to unforgiveness, you're a prisoner of unforgiveness and you cannot be forgiven by God. I'm going to say it again. If you are hanging on to unforgiveness, and that is why so many people are sad, they're yoked by it. You cannot be forgiven until you're willing to forgive. That's what Jesus said. That's what he said. I've watched these people with fibromyalgia. Fibromyalgia comes right out of the realm of anxiety and depression. I called a person out not too long ago, and I said, I release you. I don't remember where it was. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, be released from the anxiety and the depression. And the fibromyalgia left. It's beautiful. There is no condemnation up here in this realm. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who walk in the Spirit. Do not walk after the realms of human ability. Then I said, oh, then Papa, I ask you to give me a revelation of what it means to walk in human ability, because you know I've been trained in it all my life. And it's hard for me to be able to discern the difference. I've come to rely upon it. It's become my confidence. It's become the way I've lived. It's the way I've acted. And I want to just come over here and sit at your feet and learn how to walk in the Spirit and not after human ability. In other words, I want to learn how to just rely on you for everything. When you make God your trust, which is agreement and obedience, you make God your trust. I don't care where I'm at, God's going to take care of me. I just got a call from Cuba. Email from Cuba. Look, you're supposed to come back to Cuba. They want you here in Cuba because they want to figure out the things that we've got to do for the crusade. And they're advancing this meeting with Fidel and Raul. And I can hear thoughts. There's a persecution coming down against Christianity in Cuba because they're wanting to continue to show their power and their authority over the people while they allow more economic freedom. Same thing happened. Same exact thing happened in China. Same exact thing happened in the Soviet Union. What do I do? Do I respond out of fear? I rise up and say, you foul spirit of hell. I don't care. You're not going to do that to begin with. I'm in charge. You're not. Amen. Satan always wants to be in charge. Somebody said, who do you think you are? I just think I am a son of God. I think I have been born again and baptized in the Holy Ghost, empowered to represent the Almighty, and that is open for everybody. Because, you know, people come along, they think, well, you got to have some certain status. Tommy Hicks was nobody. He had no status. He had no status. He couldn't get 20 to 30 people together in a meeting. He puts up a tent over in Lakeview, Oregon. They tried to burn it down. One day, God put faith in his heart to go and meet with the president of Argentina, an impossibility. God worked it all out for him to meet with the president of Argentina, and the nation began to be changed because the president then financed the crusade in Argentina. He invited T.L. to come in to help him because he was nobody. He couldn't get 20 or 30 people together in the United States of America. He was nobody, had no status. God don't need people with human status. The status which men's, you know, votes and accommodations and letters of approval would give you. God's just looking for somebody to trust in him, agree with him. Saw Papa seeking this morning. Said, can you get over yourself and get raptured and caught away with what the blood of Jesus has done? It's cleansed you, washed you. It's made a way that you do not have to spend an eternity in a place called hell. And you believe me right now, with the little bit of hell that you experience in this life, it's going to get a whole lot worse. A little bit of torment that is you have to experience, that everybody experiences, that everybody can see, there's much proof and evidence for it, it's going to get a whole lot worse. God in his love has made a way of escape so that no one has to spend an eternity in hell and not another moment. He says, flee. He said, flee from the wrath to come and lay hold on me. Say, what is he saying? When he's saying, lay hold on me. Lay hold on my love because I'm pleading with you. My arms are stretched forth to you. His arms used to be stretched forth to the people of Israel. They continue to give him his back. His arms are stretched forth to every nation and every person on the planet today. And he beckons everyone to come. And he's called you and I to come into a fellowship and a relationship with him that everything else has no value and has no meaning, other than it somehow is a part of fulfilling the will of God. That's it. That's it. And thus, it is not in my power to do it. It's in God's power to do it, and so I'll leave it to him. I think about San Diego this morning. I'm just so blessed for all the things that people are doing out there for ministering to the children. I'm so blessed for everyone to be here. There's so many more people. And all there needs to be is a greater manifestation of God's glory and love through you, and there will be. So many poor people to reach. Just his love. Just his love. He's got to learn how to move in his love. It's more tender. It's more sweet. It's more glorious than any mother's love. It's more overt. It's more tangible. It's more touchy-feely than any romantic love. God's love is a glorious love. Ooh, it's a tangible love. And sometimes it grows in very difficult situations. It develops when you're being hated. Hallelujah. Because you just find a place of love. Not love, think, you know, that you're trying to think through and develop out of your own self. Once again, a place of worship. Thank you, Father. This is the confidence that I have in Him, that if I ask anything according to His will, He's going to do it. And if I know that He hears me, then whatever I've asked Him, it's mine. Jesus said something similar, which Peter recorded by Mark here in Mark chapter 11. And he says this, I tell you, I promise you, whatsoever thing you desire when you pray, believe that you receive them, you shall have them. And today, I'm asking, Father, that's how simple He makes this. Just asking. I'm asking, Father, to take you into a place of the spirit of wisdom and revelation so that your eyes can be open, you can see the inheritance that He has in you, and you can begin to just respond to Him. And all the burden and all the affliction and all the torment, and every satanic yoke and every lying demon spirit and everything that would cause you somehow to feel alienated and separated from God, break its hold off of you now in the name of Jesus Christ. Those of you who've not known how to hunger, you've not known how to thirst, you've not known how to move beyond the state of the expression of God that you now know, in the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for you the spirit of wisdom and revelation, the knowledge of Him, so you can lay hold on all the abundance that He has supernaturally supplied according to a power that is there, His power, ready to work in you, to produce within you the fullness of divine expression. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. There's some of you this morning, I want to pray specially for you because you know that you're yoked. You know that there's a hindrance. You know that there's things that have kept you from moving forward in God. And you know that today, it's a couple of things. Number one, if I called you out, you wouldn't feel offended. Because that in itself is such a demonic stronghold that it's on the level of not being able to be broken. That God in His love and His mercy would call you out and somehow you're offended only because of your self-interest and the pride of life, that you holding on to what you believe is more important to you than what God has demonstrated and said. But also, it's very important that when you respond, you know that God is going to do this, that this yoke is going to be broken, and you're not going to continue to live and look and be and act as you have looked and been and acted. You're not going to continue to be tripped up by the same problems and the same issues. For some people, it's doubt and unbelief. For some others, it's other forms of iniquity. Some people just don't know how to be loved. It's a yoke. God, the Holy Spirit, teach you how to be loved. He does a good job of it. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. The Lord wants you to know today, those of you who know that you've been held back, there's been things standing in the way, and you want that thing broken, that you know it will be You won't live under the harassment. You won't live under the torment. You won't live under the hindrance. Another day. Because Jesus is here to do that. He's the liberator. He's the one who's come to set us free. He's given us authority over all unclean spirits to cast them out, over every demon power, over all the works of Satan. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I want everybody to stand with me, please. Listen, please, if there's any way possible, come back tonight. Because we're going to talk about this relationship and how it moves us into a place of faith. I want you to be able to move into a place of faith that whatever you ask the Father, you'll do it. I know that James and Sandy asking Father right now for a special financial need so that they can get a van to start hauling all the people that they have an opportunity to haul. Just bring the children. Hallelujah. Go get them. And the parents that will come. They won't be disappointed. God's going to meet them. Hallelujah. If you rode with Sandy and James, let me just tell you, whatever you've been asking God, He'll do it. All you got to do is cooperate just a little bit. I promise you. And whoever you are, wherever you're at, in your relationship with the Lord, whatever you're asking, Father's ready to move in and meet it. Meet that need. I'm believing great things to take place through the events that are happening with Jason and KC out at the reservation. God's going to do wonderful things. All the different things we prayed about, different ministries. It came up several months ago. We prayed. God, just multiply them. Increase in Jesus' name. But I'm going to tell every one of you standing here, those who I just called out in ministry and those that are standing here, you cannot move forward into effectiveness until you learn how to just stand in His presence and receive and feel His love. To stand in His presence and receive and feel His joy. And then that becomes so overwhelming. It becomes tangible. It becomes that much more expressive. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Mm-mm-mm. Come on now. If there's anything holding you back, I want you to come. You know you're being held back. And you know that it's going to change. You come. It's meeting you right where you stand right now. He's meeting you. He's meeting you right where you stand. This day, in the name of Jesus, I break off of you the former life so that you may step into a new life. In Jesus' mighty name, every expression that's earthly, gone. Hallelujah. Because the heavenly moves in. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, from the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, now in Jesus' name, the wellspring begins to spring within you. The rivers of God begin to flow out of you. The release of heaven, hallelujah, begins to fill you right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Jesus. This day in Jesus' name. 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 This day. This day in Jesus' name.
joy of the Lord begins to fill you. The love of God begins to overwhelm you. Ha! It's all reminded today of a Masaga remain. Filled with the Holy Ghost. Filled with the Spirit. Hallelujah. Simbranda la lega la manda le bestia. The well springs, the rivers flow. Fire of the Holy Ghost. Jesus' name. Arrest. Name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Everything that has held you back has to get out of the way. Now in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Hallelujah. Mom, you let go everything you held on to. You let God now. You let God. Let God. Let God teach you what's right, what's wrong, what's good, what's evil. Let God. Thank God that this day forward in Jesus' name. In the name of Jesus, release. Fire God on you right there. Stay stable. Jesus' name. Fire can be summarized by passion, fire, desire, over us a time. Fire of God, Jesus. Everything that Father has purposed begins to be revealed to your life. Hallelujah. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Learning how to move in the love, learning how to move in the joy, learning how to keep yourself there. To speak till the love overwhelms, to praise till the love overwhelms, and then just move in the miracles. Just move in the signs and wonders. Move in the glory. Hallelujah. From the crown of your head to the soles of your feet, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ. Ishitaya, O woman of God, rise up with divine power and faith. Hallelujah. This is the night. Fire God on you right now in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Isotora maheo pahate pahanasapa. Moving out in the faith that Jesus Christ gives. Hallelujah. Just happy. Just dancing, shouting, singing, praising Him. In the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Shitarlaba. Whatever you ask and you think. Well, Lord, the one thing that I can ask that's bigger than anything else is teach me how to flow in a greater dimension of the Spirit, how to move in a greater unity with You. What can you think that you want to ask? God, that I'd be just so arrested by You and overwhelmed by You and kept by You, that I love righteousness and hate evil, and that You develop within me, oh God, such a resolve to only like what You like. Wow, what could you think about asking right now? What is it that you really need? What is the big foundation blocks that you really need? fire of God on you. Face the talamaya. Face the talamaya. Face the pranas de kilish de pranas. Face the denas. From the rock he brings forth water. Right now he does it. Right now he does it. We always want to look back in the history and believe that God did it. But right now he does it. Right now he speaks to the sepulcher of death and commands life to come. Mon Janet. Mon Janet. Mon Janet. Mon Janet. From this day forward, I loose you right now. I'll set you free. I release you right now in Jesus' name. I release you right now. Begin to step into the blessings of God. The outworking of His power and His divine glory. Right now, in Jesus' name. Right now. I break this yoke off of you now, in Jesus' name. I set you free. To begin to move with God. To begin to move in the realms of the Spirit. To begin to give yourself over to the things that God has written concerning your life. Jesus. 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 From the rock he brings forth water. Just the chance towards heaven. Jesus. Jesus. A wellspring flowing. Jesus. Father comes with heaven. To fill your soul with His goodness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Right now, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I bless you. A blessing on you. Malas, forgive me.
Those of you, you're just standing and you're on the floor, don't move. Under the anointing, don't move. But we want you to just worship the Lord with your tithes and with your offerings. I want you to come worship the Lord.